Okay. All right. So now this is how I said the roots are there, then there is trunks, and there is divisions, cords, and branches. You should remember always, whenever the question comes, it is always what are the branches from the different cords, they'll ask. So different cords, they will not ask what are the branches from the roots or trunks. So it is like, you know, from the lateral, posterior, and medial cord. So posterior cord branches are very, very important. It has two things. One is the axillary and the one is the radial. So those who are preparing for USMLE, this is a very important cord, posterior cord, which gives two important nerves. One is axillary and the one is radial. So here, when we go in this order, first is the roots, then comes the trunks. So there is a mnemonic also to remember this. Are you tired? Drink coffee, buddy. Okay, that's how you can remember this. And C5, C6 will give upper trunk or superior trunk. And this one, if there is an injury to this trunk, it results in a condition called Erb's palsy. Okay, so the mainly which roots will be affected? C5, C6. And C5, C6 is the root value of axillary nerve. So that's why the axillary nerve will be completely damaged in case of Erb's palsy. Okay, so like that, you have lateral cord, and lateral cord derivative is musculocutaneous. There are other branches also, but we are talking about only those things that supply the upper limb. I'll tell you what other branches are there from the cords. So here there are three branches. Here also there are some six, and here also there are so many. But if you show all of them in one screen, then it will become too confusing. That's why we have picked up only those things that will supply the muscles of the upper limb. Okay. In the other one, there is a nice proper division of all those branches that come from different cords. Now here you should remember, trunk will divide into anterior and posterior. So this black one is anterior, the yellow one is posterior. So this is posterior, this is anterior. What is that? That is all divisions. So these divisions will give rise to cords. So always you should remember, divisions will give rise to cords. So now they can ask you, how is the posterior cord formed? Ryan, can you tell me how is the posterior cord formed? Anybody who can tell me, how is the posterior cord formed? Posterior cord
from the posterior divisions of all the trunks.
Yeah, posterior division of all the three. So you have all the three trunks, the superior trunks, posterior division, then middle posterior. This, that's why, since this is something unique, that's why this is the question that is asked most of the time. 60%, 70% you can expect is posterior cord and posterior cord branches. So, and then there is also axillary now. So you have lot of applied aspects you have, and radial nerve also you have applied aspects. We'll list all that. All right. And then you have C8, T1. So sometimes in some people, there could also be C4 involved. In that case, we call it prefixed. Okay, plexus. If T1 is involved and T2 is also involved, then we call it postfix. So T2, postfix, prefix. That you can make out only when you do an MRI or when you do the dissection. Otherwise, it's not possible to make out. So sometimes you should remember, musculocutaneous nerve may be completely absent in some people. In that case, who will supply the arm? The median nerve will supply the arm. So this is for USMLE people. You should remember, if musculocutaneous nerve is absent, it is taken over by the median nerve. Otherwise, median nerve supplies only the forearm. In that case, it will supply the arm and also the forearm. Okay. So please remember that, it is very important. Now you look at all these branches. Let me move to the different other branches. How will you remember this? You remember it as MLL. And you see 1, 2, 3, 4. So 4MU. And this one you remember, ulnar is the last one here. So you remember this as ulnar. Okay. So there are various ways to remember. These things are not required. The root values are not required. So don't bother about each root value. If you remember the root value of main nerve, like the median, like the ulnar, the axillary, radial, and musculocutaneous, it is sufficient. I'll tell you how to remember also. Okay, so this thing you have to remember out of all this, even for MBBS students, this is a very important question. The branches from the posterior cord. You have to remember this nerve to latissimus dorsi. This is supplying the solo muscle latissimus dorsi and subscapular nerve, upper subscapular nerve, axillary nerve, radial nerve. All these are very, very important. All are important because subscapular muscle is the only one which does internal rotation. Okay. It does internal rotation of the arm. So that's why. And this latissimus dorsi is a very important superficial muscle on the back. It is a very good muscle for swimming. So it is called swimmer's muscle. And axillary supplies, deltoid and teres minor. Okay. And radial though, it will supply all the extensors, extensors of arm, forearm, and many things, even on the hand. Okay. It doesn't supply the muscles, but it does supply the skin on the hand. Okay. Only skin on the hand. If radial nerve damage is there, the person will not have any sensation on the anatomical snuff box. So that is an indication to show that radial nerve damaged. It could be because of the fracture of the humerus, or it could be because of compression of the radial nerve, beyond the elbow. So it could be various, or in the axilla also. Okay, in the axilla, if the person is sitting on the chair and he's drunk and he has kept his hand on the, rough chair for a longer period of time, then his posterior cord could have got compressed. And that results in tingling sensation of the extensors of the arm and forearm. He will not be able to do extension at all. So he will not be able to lift his arm. So that results in compression of this nerve, and it could also lead to paralysis of the muscles. Or it could be just, temporary numbness of these muscles. So it is very interesting, radial nerve. So that could be one of the question. Okay, this is the mnemonic to remember. And you can see here, where is brachial plexus? It is right behind the clavicle. Right behind the clavicle and, in above the first rib. So what you must remember, whenever there is a fracture of the clavicle, the first thing to get damaged is the brachial plexus, plus also the subclavian vein, because vein is there very superficially present. So these two are the things that happens to get damaged whenever there is a fracture of the clavicle. This is a very good USMLE question. Okay. So clavicle, usually where it gets fractured? Srijit remembers? Do you remember this?
What? I don't understand the question. What did you say?
It is clavicle. Where do you think it can get fractured? Clavicle,
the medial
two-third and lateral one-third, right? Exactly where there's a twist. So this is exactly...
So the junction of the both.
The junction between medial and lateral has got a twist. Okay, this medial is round. The lateral part is flat. So this portion has got a twist, and that is exactly where it can get fractured. Sometimes there is also another nerve that can pierce through the bone. What is the name of the nerve? The name of the nerve is suprascapular nerve. Okay, so this nerve also could get damaged. And if that happens, suprascapular muscle will not work. And suprascapular muscle is an initial abductor of the arm, that is from 0 to 15 degree abduction. So the person will not be able to do even slight movement of the arm at all. It will be like completely adducted arm. So abductions, but what happens is people usually support with the other arm. They will try to push the arm. Once it goes to 15 degree, then deltoid will take over. So this is supraspinatus. And there is again 15 to 90 is done by deltoid, and 90 to 120 is by serratus anterior. So this is how the job is divided. Okay, that is abduction. Abduction of the arm is very important, you know, question for USMLE. You must know this. It doesn't matter what you know in the arm or don't know, but abduction of the arm and shoulder joint is supplied by axillary nerve. Humerus here, there is this axillary nerve near the surgical neck. So whenever there is a, you know, dislocation, if there is a dislocation of the humerus, how it happens? It happens usually inferiorly, okay? Or it can happen posteriorly, or it can also happen anteriorly, but never superiorly. Why? Because there is an arch that is called coracoacromial arch. Coracoacromial arch that protects the, you know, shoulder, and it like kind of seals it. So even if this wants to go upwards, it will not go because it will get hit by that and it will stay in place. So dislocation from the socket will not happen. Okay. So they can ask you why the superior dislocation is a very rare thing in the dislocation of humerus. It is because it is protected naturally by coracoacromial arch. Okay. Next, let's see the lateral cord. I told you about the lateral cord. One second. Medial, posterior. We'll go to the, you know, number of branches that you get from each one of them. So you have, why this is shifting? Okay, we have the roots. Then we have the trunks. So please note down like a phone number. Okay, you can remember this like a phone number. It is 5-3-3-3-6. So these are the number of, you know, branches you get from each junction. And near the axilla, what do you have? Near the axilla, you have cords. Okay, you should remember when there is a damage to trunk, that means near the clavicle it is damaged. Okay, near the clavicle. So if there is a fracture at the clavicle, the branches from the trunk will get damaged. That's why I said suprascapular nerve. Okay, suprascapular nerve, I said, because the trunk will get damaged. It will not damage your musculocutaneous, axillary. Those things will not get damaged if there is a clavicle fracture. Only if there is a compression in the axilla, then only these things will, axilla compression. Okay. Only then, or fracture of the head of the humerus, neck of the humerus, then that, all that can affect this. But clavicle fracture will lead to damage of only trunk branches. So this is an important MCQ question. So you have to remember what are the branches from the trunk. Okay, these are the branches like nerve to subclavius can get damaged and suprascapular. Suprascapular nerve damage can result in loss of abduction. If you get a patient who cannot lift his arm at all, even 0 to 15 degree, just naturally little bit also he can't lift, then you should know that he may be having clavicle fracture, and that could have resulted in suprascapular nerve getting damaged. So it is it possible for all the people? No, it is only in those people who have the clavicle, whose, you know, clavicle is pierced by supraclavicular nerve. Not everyone's clavicle is pierced by supraclavicular. So only some people, like, you know, 50-50s, there are so many people actually whose clavicle is pierced by suprascapular nerve. Otherwise, it will just go like a flyover, you know, over the top of that it will go. But in some people, it will just pierce the bone itself and go. In those people, it is dangerous. If the clavicle gets, you know, dislocated or fractured, then this nerve will get compressed. Okay. Then another one you should note is this nerve, which is called the long thoracic nerve, this one. Okay, that's called long thoracic nerve, that has the same root value C5, C6, C7, same as the musculocutaneous nerve. And paralysis of that results in a condition called winging of scapula. Very, very important. Okay, we'll discuss all this with picture now. So let's go to that. See, this is Earp's point. Okay, Earp's point, you see where it is. Earp's point is from the trunk. Okay, clavicle, this is the trunk. So which trunk can get damaged? The trunk which can get damaged is, this is the posterior division. Okay, this is the posterior division. So there is medial, lateral, and this the posterior one is more vulnerable to damage. Okay, even when something gets compressed from here, the posterior one is the one which can get damaged easily because that is very superficial and very close to the skin. That's why. So Erb's point is, this is the point where you have all those things like the suprascapula, and you also have the subclavius nerve. All these nerves plus C5, C6 root will get damaged because these two are C5, C6. When that itself gets damaged, the axillary nerve will get damaged. Okay. So I'll show you. See, this is the Erb's point. And it's also known as waiter's tip deformity because the person will have hand as if the policeman is asking bribe, you know, by putting his hand down and asking for bribe. So it will affect all those muscles which are derived from C5, C6 root. I'll tell you how to remember this. See, this is how it looks. The main nerve that is affected is axillary. Okay. Complete loss of abduction because deltoid is supplied by axillary. Okay. It cannot happen. Abduction cannot happen because deltoid is the one which does 15 to 90 degree. Main abduction is done by deltoid. Okay, deltoid does all the actions except adduction. And you can see the arm is only adducted. You can see it is internally rotated. You look at the arm of this baby and it is adducted completely. And look here, it looks as if the baby is asking for bribe. Correct? No? So that's why it is called waiter's tip hand or policeman's tip hand. Police will ask for the money here and they can't lift this arm, can't bend here. So what they will do, they'll put it into the pocket, the money. Okay, that's one way of explaining the, title given to this palsy. So you can see this Erb's palsy. So this is the deformity. So here, nothing can be moved. Only thing that can move is this can move because CHT1 is completely all right. So all those nerves that are having the C5, C6 in their roots, almost all of them have got. So that's why to some extent, all these joints will be showing some signs of, deformity. So now let's see another one, clump case palsy. That is called Erb's palsy. And this is clump case palsy. So you can see the opposite of that. That means this is the only thing, that does not move. CHT1, this will not move and rest of the things will move, the opposite of that. So you can remember this as, when does this happen, clump case palsy? You remember this, clump K monkey was hanging from tree, hanging from lower trunk of tree. So you can just imagine a man hanging from a tree. Okay, which trunk? So you should remember why lower trunk I said, because the lower trunk of brachial plexus is what is affected. Okay, lower trunk is derived from the CHT1. And that's why if you remember this, you'll remember. And you should also remember there is something called sympathetic chain. Okay, sympathetic chain is derived from T1. So sympathetic chain, what does that do? That supplies the smooth muscles. We have cardiac muscle and we have smooth muscle and we have skeletal. So we are talking about upper limb skeletal muscles, but we also have smooth muscles. And most of the smooth muscles are in the abdominal region and blood vessels, they're lining and many things. And those things, we can't make out the activity. The only smooth muscle that we can see aram se is in the eyelids. Okay, so which helps in maintaining the shape. So that's why when you want to check whether the smooth muscle is working or not, you can check the eyelid. If it is drooped, that indicates that sympathetic chain is damaged, okay? Because eyelids have got smooth muscles. Okay, smooth muscles. Of course, there are voluntary and involuntary muscles. I'm not talking about the voluntary muscles of the eyeball. I'm talking about the involuntary muscles. I'm not talking about the movement of the eyeball. I'm talking about the eyelid, okay, which helps in maintaining the shape only. So there will be oculomotor nerve damage also sometimes. See, that is third cranial nerve. That is third cranial nerve, oculomotor nerve. That is a completely different issue. I'm talking about oculomotor supplies many, many muscles except lateral rectus and superior oblique. It does not supply. Okay, rest of the muscles it will supply. I'm not talking about this. But this and this you can get confused. Why? Because in both the cases you will see drooping of the eyelid. For that, there need to be some checking done. Okay. So that time the person should not have movement of the eyeball also. It will have many other things. The eye will be completely closed without any movement. That is third, you know, a cranial nerve palsy. But I'm talking about sympathetic chain, in that only drooped eyelid. That means not completely closed. So you have to look at the picture, USMLE students. Okay, you have to look at the picture, what they have shown. If the eyes are completely closed, it is oculomotor nerve palsy. If the eyes are half closed like this, the person is struggling to, as if he's very sleepy, he's struggling to keep his eyes open, then it is the T1 damage. That is called Horner syndrome. So the person will have drooping eyelid. Then he'll have anhidrosis. That means dry eyes, dry eyelids. Then he'll also have something called meiosis. That is constricted pupil, because pupil is also made up of smooth muscles. I hope you understood now. Okay, because all this is because of T1 involvement. So the question is, even for Srijit, why the clump case palsy, you know, patients may also have Horner syndrome. It is because of the involvement of T1. Understood, no? Okay, next is how to remember all these root values. So this is a chart to show ulnar nerve, okay, median nerve, musculocutaneous. So first you remember, median nerve has got all of them. Okay, first three you move aside, you get this musculocutaneous. Last two you move them, you get ulnar. My median nerve supplies nothing in the shoulder arm. It supplies forearm except 1.5 muscles, which is supplied by ulnar. So very clearly given, this full muscle it will supply. And this is a hybrid muscle, okay? This is called a hybrid muscle. Why? Because it has half of ulnar supply, half of median nerve supply. Okay? So the question in the exam can be hybrid muscle. Pick the out of the options, you have to pick one. So you remember, it is flexor digitorum profundus. All right? So you have like this flexor pollicis. All these are supplied by musculocutaneous arm region. Nothing in the forearm, because it becomes cutaneous like this. Next, you have axillary. Then you have radial. Radial supplies all the extensors. See, it doesn't supply anything in the hand. Hand, nothing. It just supplies the area on the anatomical snuff box. So you should remember, if the person is having a fracture of the radius here or in the anatomical snuff box, if there is radial nerve damage, then he will have a condition called anhidrosis. That means loss of sensation and also loss of sweat in this region. So if the person is complaining of that, immediately you know that radial nerve is damaged. So here also, this much it supplies. See, remember, all these are not supplied by the radial nerve. Fingertips are supplied by median nerve. So please look at the cutaneous nerve supply picture also. And remember, axillary nerve supplies the regimental badge area. It supplies these two muscles, okay, which are the chief abductors. Even this is an abductor, but the thing is, it is so small, we can't see its action at all. So we consider deltoid, because we can see the contour of the arm also we can make out. You can look at this picture. See how it has become flat when there is a axillary nerve damage. And you can see apan deformity when this thenar eminence muscles are damaged, because that is supplied by median And this side hypothenar is supplied by ulnar. Absolutely no radial in the hand. Okay. Median nerve can get compressed in the flexor retinaculum. That's called carpal tunnel. Okay. There it can get compressed. And you can also see radial nerve palsy. That can happen when the person is, you know, compressing the posterior cord like this. All the extensors will be damaged, and also he will have wrist drop later on. So it can happen because of all these situations. And here you can see impingement syndrome. Any tendon getting pinched between the moving joints. And this is the impingement syndrome where tendon is getting damaged. It could be because of the joint cavities, deformity, or bursae is taken up so much space, or it could be sudden jerky movement of the thing, or many various reasons. This is lateral epicondylitis. All the extensors, okay, because of repeated movement, they get inflamed. That is called epicondylitis, tennis elbow. The opposite, medial epicondyle, you have flexor tendons. That is called golfer's elbow. So you remember, golfer's elbow is medial side, tennis elbow is lateral side. And here, olecranon bursitis, it is called student's elbow. Okay, this is tennis elbow. So like that, I have some more, PPTs with the brachial plexus only, because it's an important topic. I'll send you all that. So this is the serratus, 8 digitations it has got. See, it is from the medial border. Paralysis of this muscle will result in person, if he is a boxer, he will not be able to do this. And it also helps in overhead abduction. Just like you tell attendants, okay, that you cannot do. This is the only muscle it supplies. Long thoracic nerve supplies only one muscle. That's why it's very easy to make out. If the muscle is not functioning, the nerve is damaged. Okay, this is called boxer's muscle, and this is called winging of scapula, just like bird's wing. It stands out. Okay, now this is what you have to know in this brachial plexus. All right, I hope this topic is very clear now. Did you understand, Srijit?
Yeah, ma'am.
Okay, you can log out now, and then, you can let me know what you think of the class. You can contact Nancy and you can let me know, okay?
Thank you, ma'am.
All right, bye. Okay, fine. So, guys, I'm going to stop at this one. Ran? And whom else we have here? Okay, Suhani, Yashna, I'll stop at this, okay? I'm going to send you all the PPTs related to the upper limb. You please go through once, and I want you to be thorough in the brachial plexus first, because that's the only thing that you should be, banking on from the upper limb. I'll tell you how to remember all the other clinical aspects. I've got whole set of pictures and PPTs for just the brachial plexus injuries. I'll send you all that. It is going to be helpful even for your theory exams, first year theory exams. First, I will send you all the PPTs. You study. And tomorrow, can I catch you at the same time? 8 p.m.
Tomorrow. Yeah, that's okay.
Suhani?
Yes, ma'am, that's okay.
I can't hear you.
Oh, how about now?
Tomorrow, 8.
Can you hear me? Hello?
Hello, yeah?
Hello. Yeah, you can hear me now?
Yeah, Suhani, tell me.
Yeah, 8 p.m. is okay tomorrow.
Tomorrow, 8 p.m. is fine, right? We'll keep the class short, but we'll have multiple things, because when we are recording, I want it to be, we should send it to you. That's why. If it is too lengthy, sometimes it just doesn't go. That's why. All right. We'll keep it multiple times, but we will have the topic wise. So that is going to be helpful for you. So brachial plexus, you study. I'm going to send you all the PPTs now, and tomorrow just read it up and then come to the class. Okay, 8 p.m. tomorrow, that is Monday.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.